We're going to call this meeting to order. The Zoning Board of Appeals of the Town of Deerfield will hold a public hearing on December 1st, 7 p.m. in the town offices, Conway Street, South Deerfield, for the applicant of Cumberland Farms. We have two different parts to the hearing. They're both related to Cumberland Farms and therefore special permits. What I'd like to say to the petitioners is currently we have four members. We can call a quorum, but what it requires is it's going to require a unanimous decision on our behalf. If you'd like, we can reschedule till we have five, and then it becomes a 4-1 particular vote. So I would ask the petitioners if they would rather wait for us to get one more member, or if they would want to proceed with tonight's hearing.
Ron? I want to point out that I rent property from one of the abutters within 300 feet, so I need to disclose that. Okay.
All right.
And I feel I should also disclose that my wife and I both hire attorney Tom Reed.
So, if I may, Mr. Chairman, good evening. I'm Tom Reed, an attorney with Bacon Wilson down in Amherst here on behalf of Cumberland Farms. I guess my first question would be, do you know if the town has adopted the rule that allows a non-present member to review the minutes of this meeting and bring themselves up to speed, make that disclosure, and then vote if this is, thank you, vote if this is continued to a subsequent hearing?
I believe we do.
Okay.
Thank you.
I would suggest that.
I would say on the petitioners and council's authorization or approval that we could do so, we would do so as well. I wouldn't want to have us to do something and come back and say, oh, no, that wasn't the rule.
Right. I believe it's something that the town needs to accept at a town meeting. We can remedy that by way of, if it seems like five members would be preferable after the presentation, what we would have to do at any subsequently continued hearing is just to represent everything that we've presented now substantively, so that the decision that the new member who is not here this evening would make is based upon what we presented that evening and not this evening's information.
That is correct.
Okay. I think with that, we would like to proceed.
Okay. So I don't know which portion you'd like to take first.
The special permits, please.
Okay. So I'll let your dime.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much. So again, for the record, Tom Reedy, an attorney with Bacon Wilson out of Amherst, here on behalf of Cumberland Farms and its applications here now for a special permit for the use of a 4,786 square foot retail convenience store with motor vehicle filling stations at 31 Elm Street, the corner of Elm Street and Greenfield Road here in Deerfield. With me this evening is Phil Henry from Civil Design, the site engineer, and Tracy Roll, the preferred developer. So I guess by way of a little bit of context, we have been contemplating this project and this site for over a year. We had meetings informally with the town in November of last year, but because Greenfield Road it wasn't allowing any additional access, we had to go through the Massachusetts Department of Transportation in order to get approvals, or at least assumedly get approvals for access off of Route 5. Fast forward to September of this year, we came back informally with the town, met again, and this project was really born. That's where the site design was created. And we've gotten a lot of positive feedback from the town.
Excuse me, Mr. Wayne. I just ask you, please, to tell us when you say the town.
Sure.
the town planning board, the town select board, the town, whoever the town is, because it's just...
Understood.
I just need to understand that.
Of course. And so at those informal meetings, it was Doug Finn was there while he was in town. The building commissioner was there. A member of the conservation commission was there. A member of the planning board was there. And so we had just informal meetings to gauge the town's receptiveness to a project like this in this location. And so if this project is approved at this site, there's an existing Cumberland Farms at 2 Sugarloaf Street here in Deerfield. And what would happen, and it's a small site with a small store, pretty cramped, overall 2 fueling stations, 4 fueling positions, I think 12 parking spaces. I want to say the convenience store itself is about 2,000 square feet, and I think the site itself is 2/10 of an acre around there. So it's pretty squished if you're familiar with it. In the center of South Deerfield. If this were to be approved, that site would be decommissioned. And so the underground storage tanks would be taken out of the ground with the fire department observing. So if there is any issue with leakage from any storage of the underground fuels, then we would have to clean up the site completely. We would be taking down the fueling pumps, the canopy, and then we would look to either sell or lease that area, that site, with a deed restriction or some sort of restriction that would not allow a convenience store, a gasoline filling station, or any similar use that it currently exists there, or that Cumberland Farms would look to have. So if this is approved, that's what happens to that site. We have thought of a few probably appropriate parties to discuss potential lease or sale with, and the abutters come to mind just because of the tightness of that area. Wolfies specifically comes to mind. I don't believe we've approached them yet because we're still in the preliminary stages of these approvals.
Excuse me. Please. Have you had any discussions to the benefit of the town of that property?
When you say to the benefit of the town?
The downtown could use parking. So
we'd be happy, we have not
to give it to the town or something
like
that. But
we would be happy to have those conversations.
And it'd be a parking lot.
It could be whatever the town would want it to be, certainly. We have submitted it's a notice of intent with the Conservation Commission. There was a hearing in October. A peer reviewer, an independent peer reviewer, was hired, and they are reviewing the plans for the Conservation Commission. Because as Phil can describe, there are some wetlands at this site. We're here in front of you for special permits for the use of the retail convenience store above 4,000 square feet but below 30,000 square feet with outdoor display, and also for the automobile filling stations. We're also here to seek additional signage, so your zoning bylaw allows 2 signs. We're asking for some more. And then separately and potentially later, we are asking for some variances from strict compliance with the sign, the provisions of the sign bylaw. And once we get to that, I can go through specifically what it is that the bylaw requires, what we're asking for. And I think we just need to keep in mind where this is located. And we're also, I think, somewhat interestingly proposing a town sign, and we've got some marked up versions of that to promote direction to the downtown Mount Sugarloaf. And we're really open to discussion with the town about what does it look like, but what goes on that sign as well. And then Monday evening, we're in front of the planning board. We need site plan approval and also a stormwater management permit. So if we get all those approvals, then we're in front of the select board, the board of selectmen, for an underground storage tank license for this site. So that's kind of the 10,000-foot view of the procedural path. We're going to be back here in front of the town, the other boards, over the next couple of months. We hope to work with the town. We think it's a good project for us. We think it's a good project for the town as well. So with that, I'll turn it over to Phil to kind of take you through the project.
Thank you.
My name is Phil. Thank you. I'm the civil designer. You're one of the civil engineers on the project. I guess what I'd like to do is walk you through the site and then just touch upon where the actual signs are on site, both on the site and on the building, and then as we get, as the conversations evolve, we can get more into area and so on of said signs. So the project is 1.96 acres and is, if you follow my laser there, is that rectangle. Route 5 and 10 at the lower half of the page, Elm Street going up and down the page. As Tom alluded to, we are proposing a 4,700 square foot convenience store located here with its main entrance facing Route 5 and 10. The convenience store will also be supported by 27 parking spaces along the front of the building as well as on the side of the building. We'll also have four product dispensers here, which allows for eight fueling positions, two cars, one on each side. We are proposing a right-in, right-out entrance on Route 5 and 10. Those plans have preliminarily been submitted to DOT. Currently, there is no access across that frontage, although we are in discussions with DOT to lift that access to allow for that driveway. We also have, are proposing a full access entrance on Elm Street. The existing structure is currently situated roughly here where my laser is, and this driveway is proximate to that existing driveway, but this driveway lines up directly across for the user across the street, the People's Bank. Some other site amenities, we are proposing new sidewalk along Elm Street, a new crosswalk across Elm Street, a privacy fence along the sideline of the property here. There's some outdoor seating that is accommodated along the north side of the building. Since we have 27 parking spaces, two of which are required to be ADA accessible, of which are located at the front of the store, proximate to the main entrance as well as the side entrance here. Dumpster and compactor located on the southerly side. And then over here, there's an air tower as well. These objects here are the two 20,000 gallon underground storage tanks for which gasoline will be held and supplied to the dispensers. Currently, Cumberland Farms proposes regular premium and diesel. And actually, underneath the dispenser, there's another holding compartment that allows the mixture of 89 and 93 to come up, or 87 and 93 to come up with either 89 or 91 for the gas. We're also adding, proposing.
So, excuse me. So the light yellow plate where the underground storage tanks are.
Yep.
Is that cement or is there a different type of?
That's a concrete. Yep.
A concrete.
That's a concrete, and the gray is the bituminous pavement. As far as landscaping, we're proposing 11 trees strategically located across the property, with over, I would say, 40 shrubs and over about 150 perennials and ground cover throughout the property as well. The locations of the signs are as follows. First, the freestanding sign is located here. The town sign that Tom has referenced to is just next to it, just on the easterly side of the freestanding sign. There are directional signs, very similar to enter and exit, although Cumberland Farms describes them as welcome, see you soon signs. Those will be at the entrances of one, there'll be a welcome sign here and a see you soon sign here on Route 5. And also there'll be a welcome sign at Elm Street and a see you soon sign on Elm Street as such. Those are the ground-mounted signs on site. Canopy, there'll be one sign located here on the canopy facing north on Route 5, and one canopy sign facing south on Route 5. And then the last two signs would be, there's a main building sign affixed to the building on top of the main entrance, and there's also a secondary building sign affixed to the northerly side of the convenience store, right where my laser is.
I wanted to ask a question about how this might impact the existing sign that's down in that corner.
Yes, so that existing sign would be proposed to be removed, and in its place, in discussions at the informal meeting, that's where the genesis of creating a secondary town sign. And I have, are we talking signs yet? Or?
We can, it's all interrelated.
What we did was, what we're proposing is essentially an 8 foot wide by an 8 foot tall town sign. And we took our first shot at putting together a color rendering just to provoke some discussion and thought. The sign that we're proposing would be supported by two granite posts.
Thank you.
Two granite posts, and so that was prepared by Cumberland Farms sign vendor. So again, this is just to get the conversation started. We, during the informal discussions, there was no specific criteria that was given to us. So we took a stab at it. Thank you.
Could you share with him one of those signs?
Sure.
Thank you. That's the next door neighbor across the street.
Fantastic.
One question.
Sure.
When you're talking about signs, thinking forward, Deerfield Center, the town of Deerfield has two centers, one in Old Deerfield, one in South Deerfield. So it might be
sure. A
good idea to have the signs say
South
Deerfield,
Deerfield
Village.
Okay.
Okay?
Sure.
And that would create less confusion.
And we're happy to, and I think as Phil alluded to, this is our first stab at it. Whatever it is that the town would like on this sign, how they would like it to look, we're happy to acquiesce.
So I just want to reiterate a couple things. So you said to me that you're talking to the DOT on that entrance.
Correct.
Onto 5 and 10. So you do not have any authority to put an entrance on or off there right this minute.
At this
nor
minute, no.
Do you have it to go north and south out of there currently?
We do not have the authority currently, but we're here because I think we're at a point where we feel very confident that it's coming.
Do you feel that is going to be entrance only by the DOT?
No, I don't believe so.
If it is an only entrance, will that kill the project?
That I don't know. Yeah, I think we'd have to.
I just want to point to the board that we don't know what that entrance is, what it looks like right this minute.
Have you secured a permit from the highway superintendent for the new curb cut to Elm Street?
From the town of Deerfield?
From the town of Deerfield. Yeah.
Not currently.
Because right now, I think there's two curb cuts.
And on
I
Elm
think
Street.
Where you're
yes.
talking about going is right where the sidewalk is, going into the house now?
I believe so.
Close.
Yes.
And
yeah, so if I may, we would suggest a condition on any permit, if it's approved, that if there's any substantial changes to the plan, we would have to come back before you in the form of a modification. But as I said, I think we're at this point because we feel very confident after, I mean, candidly, a year-long discussion with MassDOT through the different regional and state channels to get to this point of where we are. And of course, if it did change and it was entrance only, I think we would certainly be back before you.
My other question is the privacy fence. Are you only talking against the neighbor to the west? Or are you talking about the privacy fence coming down along where the parking spaces are? Okay.
You want to point out?
Yeah, the privacy fence would extend along the easterly property line from the corner of the property on Elm Street,
yep.
About 310 feet south, ending right where my pointer is. Right?
Okay, but that privacy fence wouldn't go along Elm Street.
No.
So. In effect, if somebody were to drive into these parking spaces, they would shine light into the people's homes across the street. That's why I'm asking the question.
Well, the bank is across the street.
The bank is also across the street, plus there's two residents that are close by. I'm not sure if they exactly line up, but...
This is one entrance to the bank, and this is the other entrance to the bank.
Yeah. Well, directly, yes, you're right. I'm just looking at the print now. But still, when somebody's going to pull in there, the light's going to...
I agree with you. However, to combat that, we are planting, we're proposing to planting some shrubs that are to be installed and to grow to about 3 or 4 feet, which is that headlight height.
Okay, they're going to be at headlight height. Yes.
But no greater, so someone could see over them, but the headlights...
But to begin with, they're going to be there so that you don't have to wait 5 years for them to grow.
Yes, at install, they would be that height.
Now, the signs that you're talking about, are they electric signs, and are they lit, and what are the hours they're going to be on?
Great questions. So we are proposing a 24-hour operation. The signs themselves are internally illuminated LED signs. And so the proposal would be to have them on for the duration of the hours of operation. So if we're open, then the signs would be illuminated as well. And putting it into context of the neighborhood for where Greenfield Road exists and where these signs will be facing, I mean, you've got the Red Roof Inn sign, People's United Bank sign is internally illuminated, the Irving sign further down the street, which is internally illuminated as well. And so this is kind of in that ilk, if you will.
But they're not going to blink.
No, they won't.
They can't, according to law.
They certainly won't blink. And candidly, this is something that we face in many of the municipalities that we go into, because this is a convenience store. We want to make sure that public safety is promoted. People can identify the site, especially now with discerning consumers trying to save every penny that they can over, you know, with gas. We want to make sure that the motoring public is well aware of the price of gas. And also pedestrians in the area understand that cars will be entering and exiting the site. And when they see Cumberland Farms, they're going to understand that there's vehicular
traffic.
We're
not going to have any blinking signs that are going to attract people to the building.
There are no blinking signs that attract people to the building. We are proposing a smart pay. And I don't know if you're familiar with Cumberland Farms. They'll have smart pay and then non-smart pay member prices. There's a 10-cent difference between the two. And what would happen is we would have both smart pay, and then it would alternate 25 seconds.
Excuse me, 1 minute. I restricted the Cumberland Farms to 1 minute.
Every 1 minute, it would change from smart pay to non-smart pay. The transition is immediate. There's no fading, there's no fizzling, there's no blinking. It's smart pay member with a price, an immediate change after a minute to non-smart pay member with that corresponding price after a minute back to smart pay member. And it's typically, as I noted, a 10 cent change. And so typically it's only one of the numbers on the board changing. Sometimes, depending on if it's like 309, we've got a few more changing, but.
Yeah, so just to elaborate on Tom's explanation is if you look at sheet 13.0, which should be in the packet, what is actually toggling, if you will, is the smart pay member.
There's some numbers on these things.
This reader right here, the smart pay reader, toggles along with this price right here every 1 minute, and that changes instantaneously with the time of change. And basically, what this would say is smart pay member 338, and then this would change to non-member 348, or whatever that price would be.
Can you see the page on there?
This is a static sign. It's not intended to toggle. Obviously, it will change daily. Or maybe once a day, depending on the price of the vehicle. But that is not intended to toggle.
This, the top of this sign here is all static, pushed through LED, so it's a solid white aluminum face. You will push through lights, and that's the branding of the Cumberland Farms. Very similar to what we see in photo Sims. I have some photo Sims to pass out. It's a little bit far away.
Does that number have to change and flash back and forth? And I'll tell you why, because myself personally, I find it deceiving, because you're watching it 1 second and it is, says it's, you know, 335, a nickel less or whatever. And the next thing you go to pump gas and it's actually 338 because you're not a member.
Smart thing, remember.
If you carry it in your wallet, as many of those cards that people offer, you know, I wouldn't even be able to, I'd have to get another vehicle to haul them around. So
I'll get it to you. I'll bring it.
I'm not sure if in our bylaw it says no blinking signs,
mm-hmm.
and if that can be defined as blinking versus changing in the words and semantics, I'm not sure that's a positive.
So I guess 2 points. The first will be germane to the blinking comment. I think what we've heard from the building commissioner is that because he's restricted it to 1 minute, I would suggest that as the zoning enforcement officer, he's determined if it's at a 1 minute interval, then it is not blinking. Some quicker frequency might be considered blinking, but that seems to me to be the threshold. As an aside, as far as smart pay goes, if you've got a smartphone, it does link to, and I sound like a marketer for Cumberland Farms, and I don't mean to be, but it links to your bank account. You're able to go, you type in your password, you type in the store number, the pump you're at, and the 10 cents occurs immediately, and you're able to track it. So just as an aside.
Right, and many places have the discount cards.
Yes.
I'm just not sure, and don't take this the wrong way. Nope. He may be the enforcer. We make the rule. He enforces our rules. So,
understood.
So that his 1 minute is his 1 minute. Mine may not be that.
Understood.
I have a question.
There's a third section to this sign. What we're currently proposing down here is an electronic messaging board. It's very similar to the type of sign that the price unit is. It's an LED sign that is intended to advertise or market certain items, perhaps, but obviously would be restricted to the same motion or toggling or whatever the phrase that is to be used, similar to the price. So
I'm getting to not like to sign more and more and more.
And so I guess just to put a finer point on it, to see if you really don't like it, I just the frequency would be every minute or whatever the board decides, if at all, and it would advertise things like milk 309, and that's what would show, and then at the next minute it would be advertising a carton of eggs, for example. I know that there are few places that milk can be purchased, that some of the products that are being sold at Cumberland Farms can be purchased here in Deerfield, and so we do think that it's a benefit, especially to alert the public to what are the offerings at that site. I can certainly understand your issue with the changing. If there is, I mean, a trade-off, and we'd have to go back to Cumberland Farms and find out exactly where this is in their hierarchy of needs. But if it was, you know, we could keep the price static if we had the electric that message board to change at a frequency, then it potentially solves your, and I'm going to use these words and they're way too harsh, but bait and switch, which is what it sounds like you're saying, because the electric message board is not going to say gas this way or bread, and then bread is a smart pay member. It's a static 1 minute. So for your consideration.
Okay.
Thank you.
So if you proceed a little bit, keep proceeding if you've got more.
Sure. And so, as you know, we're requesting a special permit for the use, for the retail use, for the motor vehicle service use. In your job, as outlined in the zoning bylaw, is to find that the use outweighs its detrimental impacts on the town and neighborhood in view of the particular characteristics of the site and its location, in terms of traffic, lighting, convenience, safety, adequacy of utilities, impacts on the environment, et cetera. And so we're submitting to you that we have with this design, and especially with the other approvals that we need to receive from the Conservation Commission, from the Planning Board as both site plan approval authority and the Stormwater Management Authority, from the select board here in town for underground storage tank, plus Mass DOT, there are sufficient safeguards in place to ensure that this is going to meet all of those criteria. And quite candidly, we think it's a good project for this site in the location that we're looking to propose. It's a 1.96 acre site. It's bigger than the Irving site. I think that's 1.7 acres. So this is a bit bigger as far as size, but I don't think you're going to get the same site layout that you have over in Irving. I think this is a more attractive site layout. If the board would like, we can go through the requested variances as well, or if you have additional questions or want to turn it over to public comment, we're happy to do whatever it is you want to do.
So what I'd like to do is, we'll probably have some more questions.
Sure.
But I'd like to see some of the structural, do you have
elevations?
The structural presentation.
Architectural rendering.
Show us what the building looks like. Show us some of that stuff.
A3.1, which should be in the packets. This view along the bottom of the sheet here portrays the main entrance of the convenience store that is facing Route 5 and 10. That main entrance of the actual door location is located here. The side door on the left side, as you're looking at the convenience store, is located here. Along with, you see the profile of the outdoor seating. Elm Street is to my left off the road. As you can see, a typical colonial New England style structure, which has been fairly well received over the past 5 years, working with Cumberland Farms and going throughout New England and constructing these sites. There's a 2 or 3 foot high stone veneer water table that wraps the convenience store. With some vinyl siding leading up to the eaves. You have shingled roofs, gabled front, and then dormers strategically located to break up the mass of the roof line. And I will tell you that the stone veneer along the water table carries through to the multi-product dispensers, the fueling dispensers as well. That stone wraps the columns of the canopy support. And also that stone planter that houses the freestanding sign is also the same material. So it really brings all the material units together.
Not that it's real important for this, but I'm curious. What are you doing about car jumpers? When I say car jumpers, we've actually at the current Cumberland Farms, we had a car drive through the front of it. That person moves their legs and so forth.
There's
here this one.
Bollards. We have bollards that are steel bollards filled with concrete, but they're wrapped in a decorative.
So the whole front will have bollards.
Yeah, they're spaced 6 feet on center, and that's because the smallest car would hit one of them, and the larger cars would hit at least two of them, most likely. Okay. So that is wrapped along the frontage and along the side where the pedestrians or patrons may sit outside.
And are they going to be painted safety yellow, or are they going to be more of a blend
white.
In?
White. Okay. We're proposing white with there's like a small green band.
Okay.
Along the face. You could actually see them in the photo sim that okay. I think is right in front of you. You could see them in part of the pictures.
You're not planning putting any solar on the roof by any chance?
Not currently in the plans.
No. Okay. But the mechanicals are on the roof. They're in the rear. So this is the elevation on Elm Street. As you can see here, this is the outdoor seating, which is wrapped in a 42-inch high black aluminum fence. And there's some what I like to call three wayfinding acorn lighting lanterns, which are LED, just downcast, just to provide some light. And like I said, that outdoor seating is just seasonal. They're secured seats that are mounted to the concrete. They're not, you can't pick up the table or pick up the seat. And the intention is not to promote a restaurant use or to even have someone there be an extended period of time. It's merely just giving them another option as opposed to eating in their car or having a coffee in their car.
Do you have an elevation with those cooling units on the back?
I do. Yep. I think I do. I'm not the architect. So this is the elevation from the sideline on Elm Street, I guess east
side,
looking east back side. West. This is the back of the structure. There's the pitch roof at some point ends and just becomes a cutout space, an alcove on the roof, which is a level platform, and it's gated so that if someone were to be up there, they would be secure and not fall off the roof. This is about, let's say, 11 feet or 12 feet and change. And these dash lines here are the mechanical units spacers, or the available where units could go. There is internal access to this portion of this roof, and there's also external access via a ladder and gate access towards the rear.
What is the decibel level of those that equipment? Is it going to be noticeable at the lot line?
I do not know that answer, but I could certainly get that information for you from the architect.
And I believe it's less than a lawnmower. More than conversation, if that gives you some parameters.
And how far is the lot line from there?
The lot, it is 25 feet at its nearest point. So it's a good distance away. And keep in mind, we're maintaining the existing vegetation along that line, and we're introducing that privacy fence.
And the fence will be on the line, correct?
Yeah, half a foot inside.
Okay.
On our side, 6 feet.
And this is the elevation looking from the south back north towards Elm Street. Elm Street would be in the background.
I have a question as to the lighting, the yard lighting and what have you, and whether or not it's going to how much of it's going to go off the lot, off the property itself, and what have you?
Sure. The sheet 10.0, which has the photometric plan. So there are a few lights on the property that cast light onto the ground, and there's six freestanding poles, if you will, that are 16 feet tall, that are strategically located around the site. The closest one to the property line is located here. That's the closest one to this property line, which is about 50 feet.
Yeah.
There's also soffit lighting underneath the rear portions of the building, because there's emergency access over here. And an adjacent sidewalk. At the property line, those foot candles are measured at 0.1, and that excludes the privacy fence and the vegetation along that line. So it's unlikely that light will cast beyond that line.
Okay. Where the point ones are, just so you can see. And this doesn't take into account the fact that there's a fence there.
How much lighting is going to affect it over here?
None.
Okay, zero.
The light is not visible over from the property next door?
I'm not saying that. I'm saying that you could, if you want to look and find the light, you'll be able to find that light, but that light will not find you. But you can see a light. You'd be able to look and see a light, very very similar to how I could see a light here or see a street light outside from a distance, but that light will not cast.
This is what he's saying.
There's also minimal light along the new sidewalk that we're introducing here, less than a foot candle, but greater than zero. We actually don't think that's a bad idea to have some low-level lighting along Elm Street.
So,
and because our right-of-way is on average about 40 feet actually off the pavement of Route 5, our lights will not, our lumens from the light will not extend from Route 5. However, if you're stopped at a stoplight here and look into the site, you will see light. That light just won't be casted on Route 5.
Question. When you mentioned about something about the sidewalk, would that go all the way up from the corner all the way up to the railroad tracks? Or just to it in front of the...
No, the proposed new sidewalk is going to be across our entire frontage on Elm Street, as well as introducing a crosswalk across Elm Street, connecting it to the bank. I believe there is a sidewalk beyond our property line, or there's a space.
Yes, there's
for,
a space
for pedestrian. I don't know if it's curved, and I don't know what the condition is, but there appears to be room for a sidewalk. But we're essentially extending our new sidewalk across the entire Elm Street frontage.
Would that be on the both sides of Elm Street?
No, there's an existing sidewalk on Elm Street on the other side, on the bank side.
Very bad.
Yeah. Are you guys going to maintain that sidewalk?
Maintain the sidewalk?
Yeah.
I don't believe so. I believe that would be a town sidewalk.
A town. Okay. And they signed up for that?
I believe that was actually discussed at the informal, and actually a portion of that sidewalk is actually on state property. I believe DOT is the one that asked for the crosswalk,
yes.
And there was discussions on providing some level of sidewalk on Elm Street within their state right-of-way. But you know, we thought it was a benefit to and an amenity to the town to extend that across the frontage.
When you put that sidewalk in, is it going to have a control light so somebody that's at your site wants to cross, they can push the button and cross safely?
There's an existing pedestrian signal.
That goes across 5 and 10.
On the north side of Elm?
Yes.
And on the south side of Elm, there's nothing?
No. It's a signal. We are actually in discussions with DOT discussing that very thing besides the access on Route 5 and 10.
But you're not going to have any great big yard lights like big parking lots or anything else?
No.
No, there's no floodlights. And as I mentioned, unlike like a Lowe's or a big shopping center where there's 30-foot lights casting down. These are 16-foot lights. They're more of a pedestrian feel.
That's the point of my question.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they are just high-intensity downcast LED lights. You know, gone are the days of those gas stations that look like UFOs where the light just bleeds onto other properties. These are just efficient downcast and do the job.
Question, when you come off 5 and 10 and where it is now, you're going down a hill, right?
The elevation difference.
Down to where the house is.
Yeah, you're saying the elevation difference between
the grade.
5 and 10 and this site.
You're going to be a lot of fill in there? Or are you just going to have it just like that?
Are you bringing
the amount of fill?
Right now, the grade drops a root like that.
Yes.
He's asking, are you going to raise up the level?
Yes. Yeah, we are going to raise the site up. Not as much, not as high as Route 5 and 10. So just to throw out round numbers, the intersection of Elm and Route 5 and 10 is around elevation 206. The existing elevation is around 204 in much of the yard of our property. The first floor elevation of the convenience store will be raised to 204. So on average, you're looking at 2 to 3 feet across the whole site. But if you look at finished grade to lawn of the convenience store, it's 4 feet. But obviously, the building is the highest part of the site and kind of feathers in.
And what is the Route 5 at right now?
Route 5, the intersection of Route 5 and Elm is at 206. At our driveway, Route 5 and 10 is also at 206. So obviously, Route 5 is crowned somewhat, and that just basically sheet flows right into that drainage swale, which is on DOT's property.
Right.
Can we take questions?
Not yet. I actually been letting a few of those slip, but give me a couple seconds. In regards to the siding and the awning and all that kind of stuff, if you look at the neighbors that you have there, now it's the new Cooley Dickinson Center, mm-hmm. but the owner of it also owns the Habitat, which rebuilt the buildings there, and those buildings are architecturally beautiful. Mm. If you look at People's Bank, even I made an effort tonight before I got here to look at a few things. And if you look at People's Bank is really nice looking. People's Bank also, their signs are not, they're there, and it says People's Bank, but it's not changing, saying their interest rates and so forth type of thing. So it really aesthetically pleasing. This is a very, very important decision here because, you know, if I had a past board member years ago, that was on the board with me, and you know, that's a gateway. That's what people see when they're gonna come into Deerfield. Now, if I come into Deerfield and I look at those two buildings that are next door to you, People's Bank, and other improvements that have been made there, there are some incredible improvements that have been made there. Where across the road, there's the little barbecue place there. Now, there's a little funny business going on how that's getting constructed, but that building there was an enormous old railroad storage there that looked terrible. And it got ripped down, and that little barbecue place is there. That is a big improvement to what it was. Where what it looks like the railroad station that the owners next door built, there was a big, 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 old, dilapidated, railroad station that was like a big fire problem. That has been knocked down and improved on to the entry. I'm not saying your design isn't good, because a lot of it I like. But I want to know, is there the opportunity in the character part of the building to make it not so stark white and add some color to the siding, the trim, and make the building look or fit in? I hear more with the colonial style that the neighbors have done, because they've done an incredible job there. So I would ask that you ask mm-hmm. Cumberland Farms or whatever that. So that was one of my questions, is there an opportunity, and I know Cumberland's brand, like downtown, is orange, blue, and white, and they've been there for a long time, but you know, could you tone it a little bit? So it looks a little bit more characteristic of what we are. Because I'll say this, I want to brand Deerfield. I don't want to brand Cumberland Farms. So I'm trying to protect the town.
Understood. I guess 2 points to that. I did have a conversation with Peter May about this project. He supported it. He thought it was great. I asked him, you know, do you have any issues with it? Said, no, no issues. I said, the fence, the signage, the building, said, no, I think it's great. We're looking forward to it. Take that for what it's worth. But then my next question would be, we've got stone veneers proposed. Would something like brick
I'm okay with the materials you're using. I think that the stone veneer you have in the front is a great thing. Happy you're going out around the islands. I think that's really good. I just think the building itself could be have more tone to it and just not be a stark white building. And what happens with a lot of projects, they start out really, really nice, and they look nice for a couple of years, but then all of a sudden the fence that where the dumpster's behind it, the fence starts to fall down, and then we live with that for many, many years. So it's picking some more materials. The materials you got, the design you got, I think, again, fits in with Peter's characteristics. So, and the asphalt roof and stuff, I don't know what color asphalt you're trying to pick, nor do I want to be your designer and be picking your colors, but I know that a stark white building next to something, beautiful buildings that have been, had color on the trim boards, different on the siding, different here, and some real characteristic that planning that went into it, and we didn't ask them to do that. Mm-hmm. They've done that, and that's the type of project they've brought forward to us time over time. So if I talk about Mr. May, he comes here and he's got a project, we have a good feeling that it's going to look really, really good. Sure. So and even across the road from there, that's owned by Yankee Candle Company. Sure. And previous to Yankee Yankee Candle, it was the museum, and prior to that it was Elder Lumber Company, which is now Leader Lumber and Hammers, is who had that. They built the store and it was a little bit too big for them. Okay. And so they had to close and go back to their location across the tracks over there. And I would say that the building, when they were building it, we thought it was going to look one way and it ended up looking another way. I will give Yankee Candle the credit that they came back in and they tried to make it look halfway decent by painting a stripe down it and trying to do some good things to it. But a lot of times, what we're told is one thing and then what happens is another. So all I'm asking for is maybe you could have some different...
Sure, and I think probably for Phil to show you exactly what those colors are and what we've got for materials.
So those photo sims are obviously your representations, they're not the actual colors. This is a board that we got sent to us from the architect that we typically use that may give you better insight of the colors, and that color, particularly the body, which is the vinyl finish, the herringbone. I think there's some availability to change the tone of that. But you also asked for the shingle. I think it's some sort of gray.
Would you bring your print back up with the front of the building?
Sure. Yeah, I could walk. I could relate where those are on the.
Yeah.
So obviously the shingles are the shingles.
Right.
The white, the bright white that you see is the trim, and then the trim being the actual white space that you see on the Cumberland Farms here, as well as the columns are painted white. The green band is this gray color located here, mm-hmm. and you could actually see it in the photo sim. There, the body, which is the vinyl, the herringbone color, and the stone, the gold ridge color that's shown there.
Okay.
That's
all
right.
If you would just pass it around to the folks there, to fit for themselves.
Do you guys like to see it?
Okay.
And I guess to address your comment about deterioration over time, and I think one of the Cumberland Farms has, if you've noticed in other areas, I mean, Greenfield, I think, has a new store, West Springfield's going to have a new store, Stanton's going to have a new store. There are these newer stores, and Cumberland Farms is making a pretty focused, concerted effort in this renewal. You see the old, the blue, the orange, and it's outdated and it's somewhat dilapidated, and we've got these new stores that they're really paying attention to, because they understand that when they come into a municipality like this, they come into Deerfield, they come into Amherst, they go into Greenfield, they know that their reputation precedes them. And so they know that if there are other stores that have become dilapidated, that have been run down with after these facelifts, it's concerning to them because a board is going to look at it and say, whoa, I just went to Greenfield the other day and it looked like crap. What the heck's going on? So they're really making a concerted effort. I was talking with a regional manager of Cumberland Farms last evening at a different hearing, and he said what they actually do is every week they have like a, almost like a secret shopper go into the store and walk the site. And if that store is well maintained, the employees of that store stand to get a bonus. And so that happens on a weekly basis. And so there really is an incentive for the store employees to make sure that they're keeping it up the way that Cumberland Farms would like it to be. And also, I don't want you to think, I mean, I'm just down the road in Amherst. If there is an issue, and I've dealt with it in Greenfield, in Uxbridge, in Ludlow, in West Boylston, you name it. If there's an issue, I get the call, and then I'm able to direct it to someone at Cumberland Farms to say, hey, the grass hasn't been cut, or we need to take care of a hole that's in the fence, and it gets taken care of. And so one of the things I think that attracted us to this neighborhood is the fact that it does have that architecture that you were talking about. It is at that entrance, and I think they'd be honored to be in that location. And I think, you know, that's where the kind of the genesis of that town center sign, or the South Deerfield Village Center sign, came from, is to be part of the community. And I mean, that's what we're looking to do. We don't want to just come in and say, this is it. We don't care if it's a, you know, round peg in a square hole. We're doing it anyways. We want to be neighbors.
Yeah. So I would say, in just a quick comment, I'm not sure lime green fits in Colonial Colors scheme. So
understood.
I don't know.
We'll take it back. We'll take a look at it.
I would ask you to go back and try to tone it a little bit more to the characteristic of its surroundings. Maybe the case. All right. Other board questions, and then I'll open it up and get some questions from the public and so forth.
So I guess, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Oh, go ahead, Henry.
Tone darker, a little shade a little bit darker, not certainly not lighter than the herringbone. Something shaded dark.
I don't even mind the herringbone. I don't think a lime
green
stripe that goes with a slate roof.
There's a more subdued green or something that looks a little more
maybe
natural.
Maybe there's a historical green. I don't know, but a lime green just is not one of those things. And
question.
I'll leave it at that.
The driveway entrances and exits, are those signs illuminated?
They are. Internally illuminated.
Directional signs, are they?
Yeah, the way that your zoning bylaw defines directional signs is an off-premises sign. We are calling them directional signs even though they're on-premises.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's really to say, here's the entrance, here's the exit, but instead of saying it in so many words, it says, welcome and see you soon. And it's Phil showing there. It's white, I think white acrylic, and then it's only push through. So the only things that you will see that are internally illuminated are the letters of see you soon and a little bit of the Cumberland Farms insignia.
But they won't blink.
They will not blink.
And I had a question that just a continuation of that on the larger freestanding sign and then also on the canopy. What parts are illuminated on those? Is it the same thing? It's just literally the words Cumberland Farms?
Correct. It's just the push through. Yes.
Yeah, so as the photo sim says, yeah, so it's largely a white sign. So the top third here has the Cumberland Farms push through letter in blue with their logo and the actual word farms in green. And then the second part of the sign here has the pricing units. This is the toggling, and this is the static, and as you can see there, it's a shade of red and a shade of green.
The canopy doesn't have prices on it, does it?
It does not, no.
No.
It does have Cumberland Farms, and those are also internally.
No, nothing blinks.
Nothing blinks, correct.
And it's essential that that sign board or structure has to be that height.
Yeah, the freestanding sign. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so your zoning bylaw provides or allows 20 foot in height. What we're proposing is a 24 foot high sign. And I think given the speed of travel on Greenfield Road and the roadway itself, we want to make sure that motoring public are able to see what those gas prices are, quite candidly. And so We've designed it in a way to make sure that it doesn't inhibit any sight lines at the ground level, but it's able, there, it is visible from the directions as they need to be seen.
And 20 feet is not enough in your estimation?
I think what would happen is, and Phil, maybe on a technical level you could correct me if I'm wrong, but it's going to drop the height of the gasoline prices potentially to a level that doesn't give the motoring public what we would feel is sufficient notification of what the price of gas is. It's really about the that 20, discerning.
24 consumer. Foot is the top of the sign.
Correct. It's correct. It's the top.
Is it, do you know, I know it's 24 feet from grade to the top of the sign. Do you know what the distance of that sign is from the grade of Route 5?
I can figure that out. So the base of that sign is at elevation 204.
And
a half, so it's about a foot and a half below
Route 5.
Route 5 at Elm.
Okay. I thought that's when you guys were coming in for the right. The height variance, I thought it was to compensate for the road level versus the store level bringing a sign down versus just another some other reason. Okay. Other questions from the board? I want to open it up to get some questions from the public and then we'll have people speak in favor and in opposition. Then we'll go to some deliberations and we'll talk to you guys about it. So I'm going to ask the public to ask the question to the board and then they'll answer it. It's not a banter back and forth to you, okay? If you don't mind. So, and I'd like to ask you to shoot a question if you got a question. Who wants to go first?
The
drainage system. The
drainage,
Dutchie? Yeah. Okay, can you just talk a little bit about stormwater discharge?
Sure. The stormwater,
we live next to the bank here, and we get this high level, water level high there, we've been good because we haven't had any rain.
This year especially, sure. Yeah, I mean, I think Phil's done a great job designing this site to make sure mass stormwater standards through the chair require that you don't increase the quantity or decrease the quality of the stormwater leaving the site. And I think that's what Phil's done, and he can take you through.
One thing we had, 3 days of rain, haven't had any water in the summer.
Soaking it up.
So as we know, there's wetlands to the south of our property, and there's a small ditch, if you will, that was actually identified as a resource area, although I would argue that it's man-made and probably lack of maintenance over time by the state, allowed it to become a resource area. But needless to say, what essentially what we're doing is we're collecting almost 100% of the impervious coverage, including the rooftops and the pavement. When I say almost 100%, there's a ridge area here in the pavement where grade goes one way or the other. This small portion here would actually run onto Elm Street, very similar to what the front yard of the house and the roof does today, although less area. So the peak rate of runoff is decreased going onto Elm Street. The remainder of the site, including the addition of this access drive, so more air, we've included more area in the proposed condition than in the existing condition because of this connection. All this sheet flows and gets collected into our on-site drainage system and then is piped into an infiltration system, an above-ground infiltration system at the southerly end of the site. Very seldom do we have the ability to do an above-ground system with gas stations because typically we don't have this much property to work with. Although in this case, the easiest, most efficient, and quite frank, cheapest way to manage stormwater is to dig a hole in the ground. So we treat it, pre-treat it, and then discharge it into the basin. Because of the large surface area,
even in the 100-year storm, the water depth only gets to about 15 inches. So what that means is we were able to design a system that up to the 100-year storm infiltrates into the ground, and there's no runoff beyond the surficially from the existing or from the asphalt and the impervious areas from the site. So in our opinion, not only we at the very worst maintaining quality of the runoff, because it's largely a lawn right now, we are actually decreasing the peak flow rate while recharging groundwater to the adjacent wetlands just 50 or 75 feet to the south of us.
Are these stores required to file a stormwater management plan with the DEP, and how they maintain that and take care of that over the life of the building?
When you say these stores, you mean gas stations?
No, I'm talking like Cumberland Farms. Are they going to have to file with the DEP a plan that says this is how we're going to manage that system?
Stormwater?
Stormwater discharge, yeah. I know in other commercial buildings, they have to file those plans.
Yes. Yeah, so when we are within a resource area jurisdiction, we file with conservation. Right. So once we're in conservation, which is governed locally, as you know, DEP gets CC'd on all correspondence. As part of our stormwater report, we have a long-term operation and maintenance plan, which not only talks about the stormwater, but actually the maintenance of the site.
Right, that's what I was getting
at. From trash to snow piling.
Correct.
So to answer you directly, if we were not filing with conservation, we would not send anything to DEP related to stormwater. All that stuff would be administered locally and governed locally. But the state does get notified, and licenses are issued on the state level with regards to the gas and spill prevention and that sort, but not the stormwater.
Yeah, so where I'm going, Dutch, just so where I'm going with this is, they're going to have to, over the period of if they're there, they've got to, like, for example, go in and suck sand out of their manholes. Hmm. They can't just let the manholes fill in. Yeah. That's where I was getting to.
Yep.
Is they can't let the manholes, not the drains, fill up with sand, plug up the system, and then sheet off into the street. So,
and that's also part of, so we need a stormwater permit from the planning board here in town, and that operation and maintenance is also part of that. So we've got it on a few different levels.
Okay. So you had a question, yes.
I have a couple.
All right, shoot the question.
Okay, so
just please state your name for the...
I think that's a good question. It's a fair question. I think, in my opinion, though, that the likelihood of someone cutting through the site to avoid the light, I think, is fairly unlikely, given the fact that person would have to be at such a point where he or she would be eight or so cars behind the light. We need to make a right in the site, then a left through the site, then a right around the pumps, and then a left onto Elm, and then a right onto Elm. So it's a bunch of turns.
I would ask that you take a peek at that.
Sure.
Because I will tell you, I happen to spend a lot of time in the town of Amherst, and right at the center of the town, where the parking lot is in the town hall, which
yes.
I'm very familiar with.
Yes.
They beat the light by going through the parking lot.
Okay.
And so I think you know, you should just take a look at it of what she's asking for.
Sure.
Of how can you deter that.
I think it is respectfully a little bit different than that, and I understand exactly what you're saying about the parking lot at Amherst. And then I guess my suggestion would be self-regulation here, and just kind of like water, humans tend to find that path of least resistance. And I mean, it's our hope that somebody's always at a pump, or it's not a convenient way for people to have that cut through.
So just take a
but we will certainly take a look at it.
These things are slowing down on the street.
Yeah. So they'll take a, I think they'll take a look at it. That's
The speed bumps?
Just take a look at it.
Yeah, we'll take a look.
So how you can deter it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay, can I clarify, the welcome sign that's lit is visible from the outside only, and the see you soon sign is visible from the inside only?
No, they are located, I'll turn it this way. So if you're coming in, you're coming into the site, the welcome sign is located right here. It's a structure that stands about 2 or 3 feet above grade. And the welcome sign is just opposite on our site. Both of them are on, the See You Soon sign is on our site. So if you're driving in, if your eyes wandered to the left, you would see the See You Soon sign. But it's just more of a...
Okay. That gets me to my second question. Okay. You said several times, there's one candle light, one lumen. I'm not too familiar with these terms, but I get the point. And so each thing is one lumen. How much is your site actually illuminating the corner of Elm and Greenfield Road, please?
Well, the corner itself...
Your property. How much light is emanating? How many lumens are coming out of that spot?
Are you asking...
Here's what I would say. It's probably from a relative point of view. Are you going to illuminate your site any more than Circle K is illuminating that site?
No.
That's the old Spuds and Buds, by the Red Roof Inn.
Right, neighbors.
The gas station by Red Roof Inn. And what I'm asking him, in a comparison sake, are they going to be equal to more or less?
Except for one important point. That place is set back quite a bit from the road. This, as several...
I'm not going to have a dialogue with you or a debate with you. What I'm trying to do is give you a relative thing. So. It's actually going to look more like, again, the sign down at Circle K /
okay.
Versus what the current sign looks like.
I would like to state very firmly that having a sign that says welcome to South Deerfield sitting on the corner of a gas station does not credit the town of South Deerfield one bit, nor will it be particularly visible, especially since one sign is 24 foot high and lit, and the other one is granite and wood and charming and way down at standing level. I think that's kind of frankly silly. And I would object to having a sign that advertises our town facing Cumberland Farms.
Well,
I would like to say that this is not an advantage that makes them look good to me. It's just silly.
So let me just answer that one, because what they're doing is they're actually doing that sign in good faith. They have no obligation to do it.
I would like to put the good faith piece in perspective. I think it's silly, and it's not to be given too much weight, because I would find it really objectionable to having the town welcome to South Deerfield facing a gas station. That's the end of that thing.
Okay.
And the light around the building, I understand that it's wise to have light around the building, but I'm not quite sure I understand the privacy fence on the east side of the property. It's only 6 feet high. What kind of privacy is, who's getting privacy? Is it Cumberland Farms that's getting privacy, or the people on the other side? And what exactly are they getting privacy from? What is happening on the Cumberland side of the property that is objectionable up to 6 feet tall that you are giving privacy to the neighbors for.
Do you want to add a set or?
And most of the activity is a little higher.
Would you like to answer that? I have some comments as well, but if
yeah, I guess to put it simplest, the 6 foot high privacy fence is to provide an opaque, how should I put it, like a separation for things that are going on with humans at a human level, whether that be people throwing out the trash or the loading is occurring. So it's not to prevent rooftops, because otherwise fences would be 30 feet, they'd be walls and not fences. So,
it's
more at a human scale.
Sure.
I would say also two things on fence. There's an old saying, fences make good neighbors. So that's the thing. And again, the fence is only something that is not required unless we or the planning board tell them to do it. And I would say that I support physical fences much more than I do support natural barriers, because natural barriers grow up, they die, they make a mess, nobody maintains them, and then you have to deal with them. And fences are a little bit better. So I think it's the good faith. But I will say this in reference to the noise. What I would ask you to do is to go back and talk to your architect/designers. Is there any, I know that that's built into the wall, but can you put a type of material in that space that is sound absorbent? So like these tiles in this room, they're there because they're a type of ceiling tile, but they're called an acoustical tile. Can you just see if there's some kind of material versus, I would say this, don't put tin there because tin will reflect that noise off. But can you look into, is there something in that compressor area?
So specifically
area?
For the roof mechanicals is what you're talking about.
For the mechanicals such that you can dampen the noise. Yeah. The other thing I would also ask you is, can you position the equipment such that it is either not making the noise echo off the building versus being out in the open or something like that? I'd ask you to study those compressors. And why I'd ask you to do that, I can tell you that as precedents, we dealt with, and it's Circle K now there, but we actually did a lot of restrictions on them around noise like that. We just had a small filling station up in the North Town. Again, we made them do a whole bunch of things like that around lighting, around noise and so forth. So if you could just look if there's some kind of background material or something that could dampen that sound, I think it'd be appreciated.
I think what we've got here, is that a 3 foot high?
Yeah.
It's a lower fence. I think, one of the things we could do is maybe just raise that to 6 feet to.
I don't want to dictate to you what to do, because I want the engineering folks be able to look at it from a cost-effective, manageable way to cut the noise down. I will say that what you'll contend with over time is if the noise is too much, you'll have neighbors complaining and so forth, and you'll have to deal with it later rather than sooner.
I think going along with that, being able to ascertain or effectively tackle this potential noise issue is to actually see what the decibel level is at the property line first, like determine what the actual noise is from the decibel back into the building, and then we can respond accordingly.
And I think that's a very important point, because I do some of this type of work too. There is just in this room right now, if we're all quiet and we're holding a decibel meter, there probably would be 30 dBs of noise in this room, and none of us talking or anything. So to your point, we start out with a baseline.
Exactly.
Yeah, so from that point, but if you can look at that, it would be great. So here you go again. One more question.
One more. First of all, Ron, I want to applaud you on the request of changing the tone of the building, because I think it would make a very big difference. I think that several people have mentioned that this is the gateway. You've mentioned it. They've mentioned it. It's the gateway to this little village that's had its heyday in the past, and now we're about to have a gas station as the entrance. And I know that I can't stop. I hesitate to call it progress. I can't stop it. But to me, I'm prepared to let go of this gateway idea because this is not a gateway to the village anymore. And so I applaud everybody's business incentive to have new businesses and stuff like that. To me, it's kind of sad that we have on the corner there a gas station at the entrance to our town. That's why I don't want the sign saying, welcome to this gas station town.
Okay, so I would, and I thank you very much, but I would also say there's a few things that are here and what's very difficult for this board. One, I do want to say that Cumberland's Farm has been an incredible neighbor to this community for several years in the center there on that postage stamp. And they have done things that we've asked them every time they've come, they've done things that we've asked them to the point of actually removing snow X hours after a storm and so forth. Some of the things we also have to look at is today we have Cumberland Farms in front of us and they're proposing this particular project, but there are that this is what we call a C2 district, a commercial district of a light manufacturing type of level. There could be a lot more worse things there go. Could there be some better things? Probably, maybe. But there could be a lot more worse things, so we have to be careful because it can be one way or the other. So I just want to say again, thank you for your comments and so forth. Anybody else want? Yes, ma'am. You want to talk about that at all? Well, let's see if they got a. You want to talk about traffic? Because I don't want to say this. I've been waiting until the end, and I'm going to bring up traffic. So you want to talk a little bit about traffic? Do you have an analysis? And
sure. So I guess just to answer that question first before we jump into traffic more holistically, I think that the way that the site is designed to allow access off of Greenfield Road, right in, right out only, and then also to still allow people who are traveling from the village center to access that without, because the issue would be if we put two onto Greenfield Road, how do you get there from the village center? There wouldn't be a way to do it. So that curb cut on Elm Street, which is across the street from the People's United, which is, I think, good engineering practice to line them up so the cars can see each other, where they are, who's going to go first, et cetera. I think this is probably the best design, and I know Phil can probably talk to the iterations of this plan, but this is the one that we concluded with because it is the best design for this site. I mean, as far as the traffic goes, we've had a traffic study done, McMahon Associates traffic engineers completed it, and essentially their conclusion was that the project won't result in a significant increase in overall traffic on the areas of the roadways that they studied. The level of service stays where it needs to stay. And the thing about convenience stores is most of the traffic is pass-by traffic. I think it's 60 to 65% are people that are already out going to work, coming from work, going to a dance or something, what have you. They say, oh, I need gas, which is why we're requesting the signs the way we're requesting them, or, oh, I need to pick up some milk before I get home. There's a Cumberland Farms. Let's pull in. Very rarely, unfortunately, do people leave their houses with the purpose or intent of ending up at that Cumberland Farms or at a convenience store generally. So we draw a lot of the traffic from the pass-by traffic, so we don't anticipate many new trips. As far as I was saying, the level of service is staying the same from existing conditions at the Greenfield Road at Elm Street intersection, so it's going to be the same as it is currently. And then I will just let me get you the information on the volume.
So is that driveway across from the People Bank entrance or across from the People's Bank
exit?
Exit.
To the one closer to the intersection.
Closest to the intersection?
Yeah.
So we're anticipating 36 new trips in the morning and 41 new trips in the afternoon. So it'll be 36 in and then those same 36 out, 41 in and then those same 41
out. Of that particular entrance or both entrances?
Both.
Okay.
And as I was saying, the pass-by trips are...
From the hours of X to Y.
Correct. And I think what we've got for a study, what McMahon did was they took existing traffic counts, took a look and said, okay, what are the peak hours? And it's in the morning and then in the afternoon for an hour time. And then they extrapolate from there to determine, okay, what are the existing conditions? What are the conditions if there wasn't a building to be built in this use to exist at that site in 2023, because that's the way the traffic engineers project. And then what about if it was built? What are we looking at for projected new trips, for level of service, et cetera? And based upon all of that information, that's where they've said we've got minimal new trips and the level of service is staying at about that same that it exists currently. At the Sugarloaf? I don't know, to be quite honest. I think, quite frankly, these are probably apples and oranges as we're comparing the two sites, just because, I mean, convenience stores by their nature are meant to be convenient. And so if you're going through the center of town and you see that each of the pumps are full or it just looks like I don't want to deal with that, you're going to go right by and you're not going to stop. This is going to be a bit different because it's, I mean, we've lifted the shoulders. I mean, we've got a 1.96 acre. It's an acre and a half plus more than the existing site. So this is really, I mean, as far as on-site circulation, off-site to on-site circulation, pedestrian circulation. I mean, it's as Phil mentioned, it's rare to have a site with this sort of land area that we're able to work with. So we're really able to design it in a way that gets to that peak of public safety, traffic circulation, et cetera. So, I mean, could we figure out what the existing is? Sure, but I'm not exactly sure what it would do to tell us what this is gonna be like.
No, I have a question because I don't wanna redesign the design from you, but why did you not exit to the rear of the parking lot, closest, I'll call it, to the fence?
It's on the top part.
Up here?
Yes.
As opposed to here?
As opposed to closer to the light. And the reason I ask that is what I see is somebody coming, taking a right turn on red, and boom, you're right into a traffic situation.
Well, just generally, it's good practice to line up your driveways with your main internal access drives. So essentially, this access drive, which is the main access drive between the spaces and the pumps, carries right through to that Elm Street. If this were not here, someone that wants to go into town that's here, instead of doing this, would have to circulate and navigate through another field of parking, make a left and then a right, just to get out. It's more of a direct route, a more convenient route to tie the driveways in with that main access. That's, you know, despite the fact that it's a lot of frontage, we do have some constraints here, right? The wetlands, there's...
Yeah.
Amount of trees.
Right.
This Route 5
acute angle with respect to the site. It's not fully 90 degrees right here. But if we had more site visibility with the lack of trees here, and we had no wetlands, perhaps this site would be pushed farther down. We'd have to introduce a second curb cut onto Route 5, mm-hmm. and or a second curb cut in addition to this over here, but not in lieu of that.
And I also think if you want to talk about truck turn for a moment.
So truck circulation on most sites, including this one, but to a lesser extent because of the land area, usually governs site access and overall layout. We actually, right from the initial concept sketch, we keep in mind truck circulation. So Cumberland Farms owns and controls the operators of those trucks. And that truck is a tractor trailer, very similar to a WB50, which is about 55 feet in total length. It's a trailer as opposed to a single unit vehicle being like a UPS truck or a fire truck. It's actually a tractor trailer. And on this site, we're showing this tractor trailer coming in and then circulating around, making a series of left-hand turns, because it's obviously easier for trucks to make left-hand turns than right-hand turns. And along its way is fueling the underground storage tanks here, and we always try to target the fueling operation on the right-hand side of said tank. So the driver's protected, it's away from all the riffraff, and they can do their unloading in a safe vehicular, in a safe manner, I should say. So on this site, less than others, we do make sure that truck can circulate safely around the site.
Okay.
And would the trucks be restricted to the 5-10 access rather than using Elm Street? They're exiting on Elm Street.
Yeah, they're exiting on Elm Street and then getting to the light to have the ability to go either way. But I will tell you that more trucks, one truck services more than one store. So depending on which way they're coming, although in this case, they're going to have to be coming from the south to make that right in. But on other sites, if you were to take an example, they make multiple stops. So sometimes that route does vary depending on the available truck routes proximate to the area.
Just a quick point on this.
About question.
A question, yeah. We're hoping that this all works out well and there are not many accidents at all, that it's all well designed, that people are conscious and they're not speeding or whatever. Let's say, God forbid, that this becomes a hazardous area and we see lots of accidents. For whatever reason, suddenly it's happening. What can you do to redesign this if it's happened? This is a concern that the community has, that people are, doing all kinds of things. Is this in stone now? Once you've designed it, we're stuck with it. And then we suddenly see, oh, there was an accident there. Oh, last week there was an accident. And we live in town. See what I'm saying? I'm trying to think ahead.
Yeah.
Well, there is a concern that there will be accidents.
If
it does turn out that there are lots of them,
if that was the case, what would happen is the town would have to get together with Cumberland Farms. The town would have to get together with Cumberland Farms, and they would have to work with Cumberland Farms to seek an alternative. But once we give them whatever we want, within reason, that is the design, and that's what it's going to be. So to your point, that's what the process would be going forward.
I mean, we want to promote safety as well. So if something like that were to happen, I mean, we would be all ears to try to figure out a solution, because if the word gets out that you go to that Cumberland Farms, you're taking your life into your own hands. I mean, that's not the reputation that we want. And so I think it behooves us just as much as the town to take care of whatever issues there are.
I would say on your what you're talking about, myself even personally too, I'm going to make a conscious decision whether I go there or I don't go there. I'll use the Circle K again. I don't always go into Circle K because I can't get out of there that easy. So we have choices where we patron, and that may be what happens.
Another question.
Yes.
So what I'm foreseeing, there are a lot of people who live downtown and don't have cars. Either they're old people or young people going to college, whatever it is. They take the bus. What's the closest bus stop to this Cumberland Farm?
Sir, over.
CISA, right? One down.
Say the town.
In town.
There's one down the side.
So by moving, I'm not complaining, but moving this down there, the people who depend on Cumberland Farms for their basic groceries, and I see a lot of people in there, that's where they buy their groceries. So the older people are going to have to walk an extra whatever blocks. I'm just thinking about traffic patterns too. Have you factored in just any of that kind of stuff in terms of numbers? The older people,
so,
college kids, are going to...
Well, I would say though, is, don't take this offensively, I apologize, before I start. Cumberland Farms picks up and leaves, we've got the same scenario. They go, this is not profitable for us anymore in the center of South Deerfield, they're gone. So we're now into that new...
I'm not saying not to do it, I'm just saying traffic patterns.
No, I'm just saying, that's one of those things, I don't know if we can control that. As far as the bus stop, that was a good question about the bus stop. And for some reason, I was hoping there was one over there by there, but there's not.
That would make sense, you know.
But that's, I don't know how those, I think the select board negotiates with PVTA or whatever where stops are.
There's typically almost a warrant, right? PVTA will look to see, does it warrant an additional bus stop? Because, and I'll tell you, PVTA has it down to a science of how long they're at, because if you're late to one, or if you add one,
right,
that throws everything else off in the entire system. So they're very cautious about where, if at all, they add. And I think, I mean, we're adding sidewalks to the frontage that we have. I mean, that's the extent of what we can do. And then if those other, and I talked to Peter, and he said, I moved out a space for if they want to have, if the town wants to have, or if the people want to have sidewalks, we could put sidewalks. And so I think that's, it's bigger than just us, but I think as far as what our part is, I think we're trying to do it.
Okay. Wait one second, Dutchie.
I just touching on what Ken was saying here, is that it's not just old people and students. It's people who are poor and have no cars and live in some of the small apartments in the center of town. So this is their shopping spot. So they may not be seen as the most important clients, but they are probably the most numerous clients,
right,
that the Cumberland Farms sees. So then it seems to me, because it's not Cumberland Farms' responsibility to put a sidewalk in from the center of town to them, but it seems to me that the town should be looking at that very seriously, because you are going to now have people we're going to get their cup of coffee or their milk and have no place to walk. And if they walk on the other side that has a sidewalk, you're going to have more crossing of the traffic. I think the town has to be
I would agree with you, but the problem is that's beyond my scope. I apologize for that. But it is. Dutchie.
Bus stop close to the store here. You're going to have, you got trucks coming in, trucks coming in, dump trucks coming in, and all of a sudden you got to stop.
Buses wouldn't go into the place to stop. They would stop somewhere on the street. Then they would have to build a bus stop. It'd be a big to-do. Mr. Decker.
I just want to point out that PBTA doesn't have any jurisdiction in Deerfield. FRTA does.
Thank you.
Okay. Second, the down south of the Circle K is the state
parking
thing. And parking the FRTA bus now goes through there 3 or 4 times a day, I believe, and picks up. And they don't do as much in the center of town as they were doing.
Yeah.
All right. And question on the sidewalks, if the town wants to install sidewalks from where the existing sidewalks are over to that area, the town meeting can vote to do it and can vote to charge betterment charges to the abutters.
Sir, Mr. Kalaszewski.
I just want to clarify a little bit on the entrances, because I've been going around with that for 2 years. The state absolutely regulates where the curb cut can go because of the line of sight distance and the distance from the traffic light. So the entrance they applied for has to be X number of feet plus from the traffic light. That's the reason that was there. And I found out recently that the Elm Street one also has to comply. So Cumberland Farms doesn't have too much flexibility to move in either of those entrances. And the other thing I want to comment on, I like your color coordination, Ron. I would just suggest that, just a suggestion, that they do a color coordination for you and bring it back for the board approval.
Yeah, I don't want to tip my cards yet, but you're going to be coming back.
The last comment is on the sign for the town. I appreciate them doing that. And I think if they leave it up to the Board of Selectmen or the board, what they want to do about that, I can even solicit businesses in town to see if they want it or not.
Thanks. Okay. All right, so are we good with comments? But Dutchie, last one, hopefully.
Ron, when you had the ramp coming, driving north on the store,
yeah.
You're going to have an exit out there too?
That's what it says.
Oh, no.
Where you're coming in.
They got to go north, Dutch, so.
You can see a lot of accidents because the trucks go through, cars go through it, in the south lane, red light, they don't. If you see an orange light, they're going to go.
Oh, it's only a go north, though. You can only...
You
across
can't.
From Yankee Candle, you're going to come
okay,
in,
all right, okay,
and right. Then you're only going to be able to go north. You're not going to be able to go south, because okay, south would be exactly what you said. All right.
Exactly.
If we're okay, I'd like to move forward.
I just have one more question.
You can ask one more question, yeah.
I mean, I don't think they have to, but are there going to be bathrooms for the public?
Of course they will.
They will. Well, it's not as easy. The Cumberland Farms here doesn't
know. I think it's due to the size.
So you have to have
really, it's really constrained.
Yeah. So
I have one more question.
You have one more, and then I have one.
Yeah. The question I have is, you don't anticipate having any freestanding ATMs outside at some point in town?
No, I don't believe ATMs. I think under your zoning bylaws, through the planning board process, outdoor display is allowed through site plan review. And what would be, I mean, maybe a red box if you go by some of the other stores. There's a red box outside where you can go and you get DVDs or games. Sometimes around this time of year, we have some bundles of firewood and also some windshield washer fluid for people to purchase, but that's outside.
But we're not going to see a freestanding ATM machine like we see down.
I'll clarify that for you. They need to come back to the board for a special permit.
You will not.
I just want to make sure that we're not granting them a permit for that.
Okay. You are not.
So I had two questions. Where the canopy is and stuff, are we going to be able to see the Ansel systems, or are they going to be hidden inside the canopy?
Fire suppression system?
Yeah.
They'll be inside the canopy.
You know, because I'm looking at that height difference, and I'm worrying, if I'm up high enough, am I going to start seeing the piping system or anything
no,
like
no.
that? Okay.
That's, I think, why we've got that.
It's a pitched mansard roof on top of the fascia board, if you
will. To house that.
Okay. And the next thing is, you're not going to be subleasing to Subway, and I'm using Subway as the example.
No, that's the beauty of Cumberland Farms. I mean, they
do their own
thing.
You've
got Circle K, and you've got Subway. And
I'm familiar with the one by your office and what
they
carry there. So
that's, that's what they've got there, and they're actually just moving. Cumberland Farms itself is moving from Framingham to Westboro, and they recently expanded almost their grocery section, if you will, just because the products that they're offering, I mean, as you know, are expanding as well.
Okay, so if you don't mind, we're going to close the discussion and we're going to go to talk amongst ourselves. You guys will hear what we're talking about.
Sure, and I guess, technically, you're closing the public hearing, going into a public meeting, and then you may be requesting additional information from us, or should I get the laundry list of what we need now?
You'll get the laundry list as we're talking, and before we go to some kind of, before we close or continue, you'll get the list.
I have one more question relative to the inside.
Mr. Decker, you're one more, as you used the mic.
I know.
Okay, go ahead.
I was in your store recently in West Springfield.
Okay.
And you now do sandwiches, breakfast sandwiches, all that. Are you anticipating doing that here too?
Yes.
Thank you.
And nothing...
Superstores.
Right, nothing is prepared on site. It's
warm, it's heated. There'll be a grease trap as well, 1,500-gallon grease trap that we have just to collect any of the, you know, if it's on those rollers and they wash the rollers and then there's some grease associated. I think there's some grease trap inside the store and then an additional grease trap outside to catch anything.
Okay. So I just, we're gonna close and we're just gonna deliberate. So.
Will we close the hearing?
So what we have is we gotta decide about the special permit for the ability to run a retail establishment in that zone of that is greater than the 4,000, less than 30 or something like that. And we have to grant a special permit to operate a filling station in that zone. And that's what we're on the special permit side. The variance side is the height of the particular sign and the amount of square footage of sign to exceed the amount of square footage of the sign.
And if I could add one more, if you don't mind, under your zoning bylaw, you are allowed to grant a special permit for additional signs. So your bylaw says two. We're asking for, after you total everything up with the directional, the freestanding, including the town, the canopy, and the wall signs for 10 signs. So that can be done through the special permit, so as part of that first part of your conversation. Okay. And the variances, yes, for the sign area, the height of the freestanding sign, and then we've also lumped in the directional signs being too close to the setback line, even though, you know, when you look at the public where the right-of-way is, the freestanding sign is too close to the property line, but it's also so far from the right-of-way. And then internal illumination and the off-premises sign, which is the town sign, because what we're asking for is to advertise something that's not on the site. Yeah. So that's kind of the corpus of
variance. So the important thing is that we have to, when we grant a special permit, the five things, there's six things we have to look at. And one is that communications needs served by the facility. You know, does this serve our community? Is it going to serve our community well or whatever? Traffic flow we have to take in consideration. Safety, and that means parking, loading, and everything. Adequacy of utilities, which is the public service utilities. Are they going to impact the town that we had to go out and hire more police or hire more fire or buy a special unit, the DPW or something like that. Impact on the neighborhood character, including the aesthetics. Impact on the natural environment is another category. And then the potential fiscal impact, including the town services, tax base, and employment. Now, those are what for the special permit section that we have to decide from. And if you'd like me to continue what I think, again, I'll say so, or we can have anybody have any discussion around those categories?
Well, you know, one of my main concerns is the noise level at the lot line and the lights at the lot lines. And that they not blink, and you know, those are some of my main concerns. I do have some concern about the traffic going in and out, and you know, it is progress, and you know, they do a nice job. I mean, I was in the store in West Springfield. It's a very nice store, and I think it's on a smaller piece of property than this is. And I thought they did a decent job in there. I just stopped for coffee. I wasn't there trying to inspect the place. But anyway, we do need to make sure that the noise and the lights and the neighbors are protected. Because once we grant any one of the permits, it's for life. I mean, you can't sit there and revoke them. I mean, years ago, you used to think you could put it in there for 5 years subject to review. You can't do that anymore. I mean, once they get the permit, it's good for life. So anytime, you know, maybe we should postpone a decision tonight, take a look at the list of the items that they're requesting, let it go through our head as to what everything is, and come back in a week or two and either vote to grant or not grant, or what have you. You know, it's a big decision.
Yeah, it is a big decision, and I'll go through these if you like, each that of those items for the special permit, and then we'll talk about the variance. So when I look at the project, as far as does this support a need of the community? Yeah, Cumberland Farms, I think, supports our community in many ways. We do have gas, we do have food, we have a strong corporation that has backing. There's a lot of great things of why Cumberland Farms is a good player here. The traffic, the parking and all that stuff, boy, if that entrance on Elm Street was down, coming out between Mr. May's buildings or something, that would be like heaven. Being up close is a concern I have. Is it undoable? Probably not. Is it the best we might get? Yeah. I don't know. That's a real, real sensitive side. Now, we didn't get to see the traffic report. So one of the things that I'm going to give you some instructions of what I'd like you to do when it comes to the traffic study and support.
Okay.
The adequate utilities, public service, we have plenty of police and fire and so forth. However, one of the items I'll give you right now,
please.
We have comments in our file from the DPW, from the Board of Selectmen. We do not have any comments from our police chief saying, oh yeah, this is the greatest thing since sliced bread. Now, what I will tell you is that our police chief has a conflict of interest here because his parents own that land.
Okay.
So what I would request of you is, our police chief has a boss who is a commissioner who is the select board. Okay. So what I would ask for is a letter from the select board saying that they consulted with the police chief. They say that there is no issue there, or state the issues that are there. So the other thing is, I don't have any comment from the fire department here. And I know all of these people have been notified.
Yes.
I have the dates right here of when they've been notified. So our fire chief, who has not made any comment about that. Now, we have some beautiful fire equipment in this town. And, you know, if he came and said, we can't get our 190-foot ladder in there, then that's something I have to be concerned about. So I'm going to ask you to chase. I hate to ask you to do this.
No, we're happy to.
But I want you to chase the police chief / I want a letter from them in the file saying we buy into that. I also want a letter from the fire department with their position on it. And I also would say that from our highway department, do they need the permit for the curb cut?
Yes.
So I would like to see.
They'll need a new permit. Kevin already knows, aware.
Well, he's aware, but I saw what he wrote here, and he hasn't made any comment about that. And so I don't know if he's going to issue a permit for that curb cut.
To my knowledge, he is going to issue a permit.
So our highway department needs to be a little bit more explicit about.
We don't need to get the permit. We just need him to say.
All we need is a letter from him saying, okay, I agree with this plan 100%.
Okay.
Because what I don't want is, I'll be honest with you, I don't want blood on our hands saying,
understood,
oh, you guys approved this in the Ron, highway department has a big problem.
$25 to get the permit. I would suggest they.
Well, I don't want to tie them up too long. I want to put them on a fast track. So a letter will suffice for me in the file that says, We've analyzed this, we support this curb cut. And the other thing, if you put those sidewalks there, he's going to be required to maintain those sidewalks. So he needs to say, yep, I'm going to maintain those sidewalks. Or he's going to have to say to you, you guys have to maintain those sidewalks. And, you know, in this town over the years, we've limited the amount of sidewalks we put in and so forth because there's a lot of obligations with sidewalks. So if you would chase those letters from those people, that would be wonderful, and especially around traffic with the police chief slash select board. Now, the select board wrote a note, and they just go, "Got any comments?" None. I'd rather they come back and say, I'd rather they came back and said, you know, I want this or I want that or whatever.
And I mean, from what we've seen in other municipalities, and I'm sure you can intuitively understand, no comment is good comment. Typically, when somebody has an issue, especially if it's the police or fire or select board, they're going to let you know. And if they say nothing, that's good. I can completely appreciate it, and we'll do what you've asked for sure. But
I would say too, but as a politician, I don't want to have to ever answer questions that I said this. We see that.
Understood.
The comedy show we got going on right now
is appreciate
a good, it. A good thing of that. So I'm not opposed to the project and that kind of stuff. So, okay. You know, I would issue a permit tonight if the other thing is we had the DOT approval there. So I don't know how to do this if us issuing the special permit can be contingent on those are the exits.
Yes.
If the DOT says you can only come in to the off of Route 5, but you can't go back out on Route 5, then the permit is null and void.
I'll come back before you.
Because yes. I apologize to say this, I can't trust you. And I know it's not you personally. We've been way too many times, we've been in front of people and it's, yeah, I'm going to put this up and I'm going to do that and I'm going to do this, and then it changes and then they've already got their permits and they're already gone. So I wished you had that DOT's stuff today. So I'm not, so the traffic and that so forth. And like I said, as far as adequate utility, neighborhood impact, I think again, it's a good thing for the neighborhood and the town.
Maybe with some of your aesthetics.
Well, yeah, we're gonna have some of those. Yeah, you got those all. We'll list them in a second. You're controlling your stormwater in an appropriate way. It's too bad those wetlands are there in your way, and they probably were caused by that road. But I would say this is that Mr. Decker and I have a tremendous amount of experience here in this town. Where Yankee Candle was nothing but a swamp years ago. It was little maple wickets and all that kind of stuff when they started that. So, you know, the water that was over there probably, and when Route 5 went through and so forth, it probably all that water is part of that whole construction stuff and not having the rules and regulations that they had years and years ago. So, and then, you know, one of the things that we have to look at is, you know, is this good for financial impact to the town? The town's going to get more tax money. They're going to get more sales tax. Hopefully, there's going to be some more people that get a couple jobs. So I think it's a good thing from that point of view. So really, the biggest angst that I have on the special permit is those darn driveways in the traffic. Is the only thing that I have. So if you can produce those documents,
sure,
and by any luck, you can get something from the DOT, even a straw vote or something,
right,
it would help.
And it sounds like part of the special permit is also the additional signs. Is that true? That's not part
correct
of the variance?
Correct.
Yeah.
So 10 signs, I don't know if we'd want to have a discussion about 10 signs, 8 signs, how many signs, if you want 2 signs.
Besides the signs, it's a setback from their property line, because they want a waiver of that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, how many of the signs are truly directional signs that say
4
entrance?
None say entrance or exit.
But they say Cumberland Farms?
They say welcome and they say see you soon.
There's 4 of them.
Oh. And there's 4 of those.
Welcome and see you soon.
Instead of entrance and exit.
Not, no branding. Branding's only on the big sign.
It doesn't say
and
Cumberland
on the building.
Farms.
There's no text branding.
Right.
There's their architecture.
Yeah, probably the same as the best. Just to put a finer point on it, to Mr. Wadham's point, the additional signs is part of the special permit packet. What you're talking about with the proximity to the setbacks is part of the variance packet.
Okay.
It's really just a function of how your bylaws are.
We'll make sure we get it right.
I trust you will.
So these are the welcome and see you soon signs. So as you can see, it says see you soon. It has the leaf brand wrapping the sign itself. And keep in mind, these are only 8 inches wide, and they stand about 3 feet top grade.
The whole sign is only 8 inches.
8 inches, 8 inches wide, 3 feet high, and 1.5 feet.
They're very small.
Small.
So when you have snow, you won't even see them.
Any comment on this?
So that's four of them. Then you've got the two canopies, the two on the building. That's eight.
The freestanding Cumberland Farms sign, and then the freestanding
town sign.
Town sign.
Okay. So that would cover the special permit.
We got one more thing. Go backtrack on the crosswalk for the new crosswalk they're putting in. I'd like to make sure that it's got the button for people. They're going to hit the button to get the light to cross so they don't get hit.
And have a,
you know, there's a button to go across
lock.
5 and 10.
Yeah, that is under Mass DOT jurisdiction.
Right.
And we are vetting that out with DOT now.
Right.
And we have been vetting that out for some months.
It's up to them.
But, yeah. You know, I'm just looking at right now, I wouldn't be very happy to see somebody get killed trying to walk across there because there's a thing that stopped the traffic the other way. Okay?
Yeah, our traffic engineer is looking at that and in discussions with DOT depending on what is warranted there.
I don't know, do we have any jurisdiction over that? I know it's the right thing to do because across the street from there is a lot of housing that will patron your establishment. So they're going to come across the road. They're going to walk over here. So I have the feeling that they're going to be in front of DOT of how to cross that road.
I just think that
I don't know how we handle that.
We'd like to see it if the
we'll exert good faith effort, but I mean I think that's about as far as we can go. Hopefully we've made a presentation in front of you where you do trust us and know that we're not just, you know, what we say is what we mean, and we're here to try to do it. We're not just saying and saying, oh, screw them, we're out of here, but we're trying.
But, you know, you have children in town that leave the schools, and right now they're beelining down to the center of town this afternoon at 2:30 or so. One of them was my grandson, and I know he was going to Cumberland Farms because that's one of his favorite places to go.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if you're over there, these kids are going to be over there. Some of the kids are going to live over it on that development on the other side of 5 and 10, and they're going to be back and forth all the time. And I just very cautious that somebody, I don't want to see somebody get hurt. And I don't want to add to the hazards. And I think without that light, you could add to some of the hazards that face the inhabitants of the town.
So I would, to go a little further with what Ben talked about earlier, can you adjust your color palette and just bring us back your color palette with what you're proposing? Just tone it down a little bit. No lime green sign, stripes, slate gray roofs.
And the dust bowls aren't going to increase at the lot line?
Right. We'll take a look at that, and I'm sure. I mean, by the nature of the use, there's going to be, I mean, there's right now a vacant field, so compared to that and cars driving into the site, there's going to be.
But the ambient noise of 5 and 10 is huge, too.
I would imagine.
We just dealt with the fire department.
Yeah, yeah.
They did a study, and that there was a lot of noise over there.
Traffic noise.
Yeah.
And that's precisely how they're going to measure. They're not going to measure the absolute noise. They're going to measure the what is above ambient.
Yes. Yeah. So, okay. The other thing I'd ask you, whoever does, go back to Cumberland Farms. And this is not part of conditioning, nor am I voting on this. but I would ask Cumberland Farms to consider talking to the town about that piece of property before it goes private. So
the existing site?
The existing site. So go back to Cumberland Farms and bring it to them and say, you know, what can we do in good faith with the town? Because that would be a very powerful asset to the town versus to the, I'll even say the abutters, with what we're facing with parking in town and so forth. If whether it's first right of refusal, whether it's...
Well, they might get a nice charitable deduction out of it. Probably.
Whatever. Well, what's it called now? The in lieu of tax, a pilot.
Payment in lieu of taxes.
Right. You know, maybe there's a pilot or something like that. I don't know. I'm just, I'm trying to think forward.
But if they decided to donate the site after it was cleaned up, right, they would get a hefty charitable deduction from the...
I don't want to get into that. All I'm asking is
Donald
plant
Trump
the seed
company.
To talk to the town, sure. To the select board and so forth about that piece of property before it goes out from underneath the select board. If the select board says, we don't want it,
right.
Then okay, but if the select board says, geez, you know, that's not a bad idea, that is an important
an
piece of property to us.
Right of first refusal,
yeah, something like that. And that's not, and let me just also make it very clear, I'm not voting at all on that.
On behalf of the board.
I'm just asking on behalf of the town to do that. So, and you're gonna try to tone it down, you're gonna look at the noise, and I respect the lighting, I think the lighting, and I know what kind of acorn lights you're talking about and so forth. Those are really nice, and nor do you want to burn any more energy than you have to as well. So any other types of things we'd like to ask them?
Just as far as the special permit?
Just as far as the special permit.
No.
Mm-hmm. All right, so so you've got those, the big thing is those few letters from those few other people in town. And the DOT, what we probably will do when we go to to grant a special permit, the DOT part, we probably would make it conditional that if it doesn't look like this, within reason, with minor adjustments. But if they said to you, no, you're not exiting to the north, that's a substantial difference. Then, well, can you go 10 feet this way or 15 feet that way, type of thing. So that's on the special permit. On the, as far as the variance, what are we're looking for the height on the variance.
Internal illumination.
In the illumination, talk about the illumination again.
So your bylaw prohibits internal illumination. We are requesting internal illumination for
of
all
the signs.
Internal illumination of all the signs. Yeah, instead of, let's say,
flat
uplighting or some goosenet, something
right,
like that.
Right.
I think it's because of the location that we're at, given the...
Yep.
Frequency of the traffic, you want to make sure that you give the public notice.
Right. The internal illumination doesn't bother me as much as the, I'm going to call it flashing,
mm-hmm.
oscillating.
Yeah.
Is not, I just think that's, in our bylaw it talks about no oscillating signs, no flashing signs is in our bylaws. So I have a real angst.
And another thing too is because you may be changing what is on that particular spot in your sign too, as to like the different prices for this or that. That can be distracting and confusing for someone who is driving a car or whatever. All of a sudden it's like, oh, well, what was that, you know?
And I would even say, if you look at our, when you leave here right there, that bank,
mm-hmm.
the savings bank.
The time and temperature.
Well, not even that. It's a beautiful bank.
Mm-hmm.
And they came to us. They had an ATM machine, and the ATM machine blinked.
Mm.
We contacted them and said, no. And they fixed it. It doesn't blink anymore. Because as you came through town, the first thing that caught your eye was that little green flash over there on the ATM
sure.
machine. So I know what you're trying to do there, but I think you need to find a different way to communicate. Here's our card club owner's price,
mm-hmm.
and here's the regular price.
Yes.
But to be flipping back and forth is...
So, maybe out of the spirit of compromise, and I don't know what Cumberland Farms, I mean, we'll go back to them and bring this to them, obviously, but if we were to have just a static price of whether it is non-member or member, mm-hmm. whatever it is, or member, non-member, and then mm-hmm. you know, maybe we have diesel, which is one of the other ways that they do these signs. Would you be okay with that message board with the advertisement of milk or if it's but a 1 minute? I mean, because around the corner at that bank, you've got a time and temperature that alternates. Yeah. And I don't know the frequency of the alternation because I think to your point, I mean, and there are studies where if you do it every 25 seconds is the optimum time because people do have the opportunity to see it. I think if it's a minute, given the speed of travel on the adjacent roadway of Greenfield Road, that minute, it's not going to, I mean, for somebody to be a whole minute to see it switch multiple times, if it was 10 seconds, 5 seconds, something like that, I could see that being a blinking or a problem visually that catches out of the mm-hmm. corner of your eye and is distracting. And that's not what we want. And so, to the building commissioner's point earlier, the 1 minute at least gives, and maybe even a minute 30 seconds. I mean, I don't know if there is a.
So let me ask you the question. There. On the sign where you're going to say hot dogs 2-for-1 today.
Ooh.
That sign.
Yes.
How long is that going to say hot dogs 2-for-1?
That's what I'm suggesting, a minute.
So a minute.
A minute.
Okay.
And then it changes
So let me give you an example. Gatorade. There's nothing stopping one of your competitors from coming in and saying, going outside and putting up a sign that says hot dogs for
$2 for $1.
A physical one.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not going to change that every single minute. It's going to be there for the day, probably at the minimum. And hopefully they're running it for the week special or whatever it may be. So I'm not sure, again, I really don't like that 1 minute changing information. So I think that is really just a rolling type of illuminated advertisement. So from the variance point of view. The other thing I would say, 20 versus 24 feet is another variance, and technically with a variance you understand a variance 100 doing what
soil
you do
shape, topography,
you know exactly what a variance is and what it does and how you defend it and can't defend it and so forth. So it's a real fine line here. So I think to your point about compromise, I'm willing, and I'm taking my only position, they're listening to what I say, I'll compromise the internal illumination, and I wouldn't compromise the height from 20 to 20, whatever, 4, but I'm not sure I'm going to compromise the flashing. So I think that's where we are. So you can, if I had to vote on the variance I would vote for is the internal illumination and the height, but not that. So if we vote no on the variance, it's a flat out, you don't get anything.
Understood. Yeah.
So I don't know who makes that determination. I think you're going to have to go back to Cumbie's and make that decision with them.
What's the hierarchy?
What do you want? Right. Do you want nothing? I don't mean I'm not being...
Right. No.
Would it be different, Ron, if it were up, like you said, if it were up daily or if it were a daily special?
I think if it was something that wasn't so frequent, I think might be considered. Because, you know, if it was a, maybe if it was an updated daily thing. But with a message board, you don't have much control over the message.
Right.
And the message could be, you know, it could be a positive message or it could be a negative message, you know. They could put anything they want on a message board.
Mm-hmm. There's one.
I just wanted to comment further on the aesthetics because I think that is a really important thing, and to address all the comments that were made here tonight about, you know, the feel of having this here, which is, you know, monstrous comparatively. And if the aesthetics are just a little calmer, and I'm sure you have design people who can just take an idea and give you a million different ways to do things, but...
Of the sign or of the building are you talking?
The sign.
Okay.
Yes. And the building is, you know, you're already on the right track on that tonight anyway.
Mm-hmm. Question. You talked about the three prices, the two prices of gas and then the smart pay price, right? you don't put anything up about the diesel?
So the sign has the smart pay, which would change to non-smart pay, and then underneath it is the diesel price, and that stays. There's no smart pay.
So there's three. I thought the picture I saw, only saw two.
Exactly. So this is the, you know, the toggle piece, right?
They were toggling. Smart pay, not smart pay. Right. Smart pay, not smart pay.
Yeah, and this is the static.
And then and the bottom one.
And that one's the diesel? Okay.
And let me jump in once more, and I'll have to correct myself thanks to what Phil pointed out. It's 25 feet. So it's an additional foot on top. I said, I've been saying 24. And
yeah,
I
it's 25. Height, it's height. Yes.
Now, is there a reason that you have to display the not discounted price, or like, is that illegal?
I would imagine that if there has to be a standard, it would have to be the standard of what everybody would be paying. But if you sign up for this, then.
Right.
So,
yeah, but no, that's you know, 90% of the gas stations you go to, they have a rewards program, but they don't advertise the, again, I hate to say this, the rewards price. They advertise the price of fuel. When you get there, you have your rewards. And so I don't mean this in a bad way, but it is a bait and switch thing, because I've even personally come through town and seen your sign in town say, oh, gas is, you know, $2, and I go in there and it's $2.10, and it's, well, why? And then it's, oh, if you've got a rewards card, right, it's $2.10. So I don't want to say it's bait and switch, but it probably isn't far from the borderline of the bait and switch. So I would be, that's my angst on
it.
I think that,
we'll
so
take it
you
back.
Need to go back Certainly. To Cumberland Farms. Yeah. When you come back, you need to say to Cumberland Farms, what's your priority? Because right, it's going to be, and I don't mean this, it's going to be nothing,
yeah,
or it's going to be...
Or you give up the...
You got to give up the flashing.
Okay.
The flashing sign. And, okay, and then you stay within 25.
Yeah. And where did we end up on the electronic message board?
What's that?
We don't like it.
No electronic message board.
And no electronic message board.
You know, like...
Or it's complying with the bylaw. Right.
Comply with the bylaw. That's right.
Okay.
As far as the number of signs and the special permit, again, I'm not an angst at all with, sure, numbers.
So the balance of the sign package besides that
seems
toggling, you're okay with.
Seems, from my perspective,
it's not a deal breaker. I don't really care for the ones going in and out, but it's not a deal breaker.
Yeah. I mean, they do help. I mean, from what we've found, they help just to give people a sense of okay.
But the problem is that they're not at the edge of the curb. So they're back 10 feet, so when you're driving in the rain and it's dark out like it was last night, that's not going to do you any good trying to find where the curb cut is coming in, because these signs, those particular signs you're targeting, are putting in 25 feet back from the road.
Hopefully they'll have fog lines and so forth.
Yeah, and I mean, that I think is more germane to the DOT entrance. I mean, the other ones are as close to, I think, as we can get them on Elm Street. And, you know, a lot of this, just like with the smart pay member, hopefully this becomes intuitive to the consumer. So if they see the regular price, they know, oh, well, I've got the smart pay, it's 10 cents off.
Yeah.
I can figure out what 10 cents is. Similarly with the entrance and exits, after enough time of doing it, they should say, well, here's the entrance, here's the exit. So,
and I think for the most part with people, you have loyal customers or you don't.
Yeah.
It really isn't gonna, if somebody coming from Connecticut, if they're a Cumberland Farms person, they're going to come to Cumberland Farms and they're going to use their card or so forth. And I would say this, and this is going off the cuff a little bit, but you generally patron the places that are convenient for you in your lifestyle and where you go. Myself, even personally, I used to get my medications from CVS in Greenfield. I have to come home and go there. I work down in the south side of the town. So why am I going north?
Mm-hmm.
Well, now I'm going to patron the south side where I work. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what happens with people. So I'm not sure that's buying them as much as, other than, again, at bait and switch, oh, there's cheap gas, I'm going there. And then I get stiffed.
So you should sign up, it's really easy.
I know. So,
okay, but you have to have money in the bank.
that's the rub.
So what I'd like to do is continue the hearing,
sure,
let you bring that stuff back, and then we would make some kind of vote to move forward. And so I guess I would ask you to look at your schedule, and what does your schedule look like, yet we can come back.
When do you think we can get the information from the town? I mean, what are we going to do? When are you available?
We're going to be, well, that's, I'd like to do it. I don't know how folks feel about it, but I'd like to do it sooner than later. So this is, this Thursday is like the
8th.
The next one would be the 16th.
15th.
I mean, that's probably not a bad.
There's a sewer study committee meeting that night already.
Yeah.
Oh.
They've been studying it for how many years?
All right, fine.
We can go into another room. It's not like.
But I'm supposed to be in that one too.
Oh.
No.
That's my point.
Well, we need you.
Yeah.
We have to have you. But I'd rather deal with it, because the 16th, after the 16th, the 23rd, and that's getting too close.
To so you want to do it at 7 o'clock that night?
On the it was 15th, is it? Is that
15th, 7 o'clock?
So we have to make sure that it gets posted.
Bill's a busy man.
Properly, because we probably won't have this room. We'll have to go into the one of the other rooms.
Continuation.
Yeah.
But we can continue it from here. But like,
oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, there's no legal problem. As long as you set the 7 o'clock on December 15th in the municipal offices.
Even if we're just claiming this building.
Right. I think that's sufficient.
Mm-hmm. So, is that good? Because I think I'd like to do that.
Yep.
I'm going to be here anyway.
All right. So, yeah, we're going to make a motion to continue the hearing until December 15th.
I might suggest that he give us a list of the items, you know, regular check-off list of everything he wants included in the various votes, so that we make sure we do it right.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I'm happy to do that.
When it comes time to do it,
so
if we choose to do it.
Also, I'd ask you, too.
Thank you.
I mean, we say 7 o'clock. It doesn't have to be 7 o'clock. I mean, does it matter to...
The other one's posted for 6, that's why.
Oh, posted for 6. Okay,
I mean, heck, yeah, I could do it. We could do it.
I'm
in
just
the
again,
afternoon
I feel
want.
Bad for you guys. You're here. We're not usually here this long. This is really
we
ridiculous.
We got time and a half tonight, 2.5 hours.
We're not.
I apologize.
No, that's not you. So.
Yeah, I mean, at your convenience. I mean, we could 5 o'clock. Yeah. Phil suggests 5 o'clock. Tracy suggests 5 o'clock. I mean, I don't know how it works.
Well, my only problem, sometimes I have problems with childcare. Grandchildren, so whether I can bring them,
they're fine. Well, as long as they speak in favor, I think.
Seriously though, on the 15th, could we do? There would be no reason we couldn't do 5.
We can do it if I bring the kids with me.
5 o'clock or whatever.
Yeah.
You can adjourn anytime you want, Ron.
Right. I know.
All you have to do is say the date and the time, and you can change rooms. That's allowed.
You don't really have to repost, I don't think, either. But
you don't have to repost.
No, there's no legal notice to it.
No legal notice required.
Would 5 be?
5's great.
5 good? That day, I know, I'm sorry, you probably traveled.
Thanks.
A long way. But. All right, so let's go 5 o'clock that day.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very
on
much.
On the 15th, in the town offices in Deerfield. So let's have a motion to do that.
So moved.
All right, so we're going to continue till the 15th, 5 p.m.,
do you need
a second and a vote on it?
Yeah, we need a second and a vote. Yeah.
I second that.
All right, we'll second it.
Do we have to do it for both filings or one, or can we do it combination?
We'll do it for both at once.
Okay. All right.
How do you vote?
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Okay, so we'll see you back on that. Just try to get those few things nailed.
We'll do.
And then we'll go, because you're going to have to go through those other boards anyway.
We know. Thank you very much.